Janet Golea spent most of her formative years in Germany, which afforded her a broad view of life and art. She relocated from Europe to California to pursue her art and received a BFA and MFA from the San Francisco Art Institute. A writer, educator, and curator, Janet focuses on what she describes as issues that are often in direct conflict with one another, such as depth and flatness, nature and artifice, expression and precision, and spheres and circles. Her work has been shown at the San Francisco Art Institute, Shepard Fine Arts Gallery, and Sierra Nevada Museum of Art, Artist Space, Guildhall, Asherwalk Hall, Sarah Nightingale Gallery, as well as Gallery Muhlenbusch Winkelmann in Germany. Please welcome Janet Golea. Thank you.
What a nice crowd. Thank you all for coming. And special thanks to Corinne and to the parish for organizing such a provocative and intelligent show. It's really compelling, so I'm thrilled to be a part of it. I have assembled a small group of selected works that relate to the works that are on view here at the parish, which are these three paintings on paper. And I've tried to sort of traverse various aspects of my work since I love lines. I think since I first picked up a pencil, it's been a major force in my practice. But not all of my work is about lines. So I hope I've put together a group that tells the story of 40 years of making art. So I think if you give me a piece of charcoal and a rectangle, I just completely start to dissect it and draw diagonals and crisscrosses. And I think when I was a child, I really believed that there was magic in my pencil, also in my fingertips, but it was so profound to me that mark making could tell such a robust story. So putting pen or ink or charcoal to paper is such a natural part of my being. And I'm happy with these three works, and I hope that I can tell the story of how my work has moved between the linear and more volumetric pieces. So the works that are on view here at the parish are very recent, done within the last 2 years. But these works, which are very related, are from the mid to late 1980s, not too long after I moved to New York City. And in that same sense of trying to activate a rectangle or carve a form into a white space, these are, you know, very much related to the works that are on view here. When I embark on this process, for me, it's actually very combative. I sort of go into the paper like a stormtrooper and then work until I can resolve this kind of a mess that I've made. And, you know, no one's forcing me to do this, but I seem to rely a lot on instinct and throwing paint on a surface and then working through the geometry of it until it starts to resolve itself. One of the things that I love about these two pieces and the pieces on view is that sense of pentimento and this vestigial image that both comes forward and recedes into the background. So when I first lived in New York, it seemed no matter where my studio was, it was always in a basement, usually in somewhere in Tribeca. And no matter how many lights I would put up, I always felt like I was painting by candlelight, like I was living in the raising of Lazarus. And my works from this period reflect both that light and that sense of dankness and darkness. But this painting, which is called Pink Agate, came directly out of these linear forms that I was painting on paper. And along the way, they acquired a sense of the botanical. In a sense, they created a life of their own. I have no idea where this botanical imagery came from, but it came very naturally. And once again, I love to move the image field forward and backward and to focus on both deep space, middle space, and foreground. When my son was born, I scaled down my work considerably. So in New York, before I was a parent, I was painting pretty large paintings and couldn't, you know, had to rethink a few things after I became a mother. And one of the first breakthroughs in that period of my life, when I was working and mothering and painting, were these a series of these works that handle that deep space, front space, and middle space in a different way. I really liked them, and I felt like they were sort of sexy, and in my opinion, and almost fleshy, those orbs that move in between a sense of dimension and flatness. And that was really satisfying for me. I love to paint in gouache, and you know, my canvas paintings are usually oils, but there's something about the way gouache moves across the paper on the brush that just fills me with complete joy. This is another one. Again, they're tiny little paintings on paper, but I love the sense of spatial depth that I was able to play with in this series. It's funny, when I lived in New York, I was affected by its constant right angles. Every window had a right angle, maybe a diagonal here and there. But when I moved out here, I feel like every window I look through is a drawing, particularly this time of year when all those bare branches and twigs carve a line drawing in a rectangle that is the window I'm looking through. And it turns out I'm extremely affected by my environment. So I think that imagery has really penetrated my thinking in a certain way since I've been out here. So cut to the present. I am very drawn to the natural things that paint is. Slushy, drippy, mysterious, strident. And in much of my work, I impose images of precision on top of or inside a more gestural ground. And I really just love to throw paint around. I know when I was in 9th or 10th grade, I lived in Germany, and my teacher showed a film. It was a close-up of a man mixing oil paint with a palette knife. And I was just complete. It's like my favorite film ever. So, and that's never really changed. But it's not always easy for me to resolve a luscious background with a sense of precision on top of it. So I was really happy with this painting, and some of this comes from my interest in geometry and cutting circles and squares and dividing up space. But it also was a result of the recent eclipse, the solar eclipse that we had a couple years ago. And I have a long history of staring up into the sky for hours and hours, big part of my childhood. And I find in the sky, the night sky in particular, a similar foreground, background, depth concept. So I was thinking so much about the eclipse that I started seeing circles everywhere. And it became maybe a kind of portraiture in my work, and allowed me to satisfy a lot of my interests. So this painting, to me, it doesn't really translate on the screen. It's actually a much different color and a kind of darker imagery, but it's essentially about the same thing, the sense of eclipsing or rolling over circles and star shapes. And these works sort of began with taking a loaded brush of paint and pivoting it around a center point so that it would create a circle. And I was particularly interested in that because there was such a high probability of failure. And I found that kind of fascinating. And I did a whole body of work based on that concept. But for me, it was almost impossible to enact that process on a large-scale oil painting. So I've been working to come up with a different kind of methodology. This is, I think, the first painting in this series that I did, and I like it so much. And I like the horizontal brush strokes because it reminds me of the water that we're surrounded by, and like the brambles I see out of my windows. It turns out the water and the horizon line has also had a huge impact on my work. It's been very satisfying and really hard to paint those circles, but when you see the paintings in the flesh, there's parts that are rich with linseed oil, so they're very glossy, and other parts that are flat. And it also satisfies my desire to throw paint around and then insert a sense of precision on that ground. This too, in this case, I wanted to broaden the image field. And in some of my work, I play around with the edges of the canvas or the drawing and run lines or objects off to the side. But this was particularly fun for me. And it always, this one's called Mirror Skies. And it always reminds me of the Emily Dickinson poem, The Brain is Wider Than the Sky. And even though it's not such a big painting, I work in a really tiny studio. So this painting just consumed all my peripheral vision. And it's really not that big, but it looks really big in my house. So along this same concept, as I was dealing with all these orbs and spheres and flatness and depth, I started splicing them up and chopping them and overlaying them. And this is just one part of a diptych, but I wanted to show it separately because I think you can see where these circles are interfacing. And I'm very drawn to the sense of scatter in the rectangle. Reminds me of concrete poetry and John Cage and all that. And really, I just want to activate the picture plane and have a sense of depth and mystery. But more than concrete poetry, it reminds me of the magic eight ball that I loved when I was a kid. And I think everything that magic eight ball meant to me is exactly who I am today. The idea of words coming up out of that inky blackness and telling me some ultimate truth. So when I started painting these, it was so fun to deal with, again, with middle space and deep space and frontal space. This one's called Short Midnight. And I have to say, as a kind of aside, sometimes it's just heartbreaking to paint over these grounds because I love them so much. But I'm not a minimalist painter, so I really have to paint over them. But these two canvases were just such luscious, had such luscious grounds on them. And I was reading recently an interview with Chris Martin, the painter, and he said, you know, there's always that temptation to build the whole painting around your favorite part of it, and that usually kills a painting. He said, now when I find that favorite part, it's the first thing I paint out. So I think that's an interesting philosophy. And these complex forms really did cover up just about everything in this imagery. This is called Blackbird. And it's another diptych, a similar concept. It's on view through this weekend at Sarah Nightingale, along with some other works. And I felt that it was successful, and I was very happy with it.
And this is one of the first of these diptychs I did, which is a little bit different because it plays with this illusion of transparency. And it was complex and really fun to paint. So this is a little bit of a non sequitur, but I love this painting. And instead of inserting that sense of precision or objectness on top of or inside of a gestural ground, I created a sculpture. And to me, it looks like it's poking out of that image field. And as I mentioned, I have a number of different bodies of work, and this is part of a body of work that deals with line in a much different way. It's very related to the water by which we're surrounded. And I call it the Arroyo series because it's very much about fluidity. And back to the paintings that are on view here at the parish, these are a little bit more recent. They're less about drawing and more about volume and shape. But I continue to do this at the same time as my other work. And this is the center painting. It's called Invisible Fish. It's the center painting in the imagery in the hallway. So thank you very much.